Carpets is a huge warehouse full of carpeting in every style and color imaginable.
Selection is just a part of our story. What we're most proud of is our low, low prices.
How would you rate Dream Carpets?
Well, I think the selection is just great and the prices are low.
On sale now at Dream Carpets, Burlington Antron Plus Nylon, $25.95 a square yard, completely installed.
Dream Carpet, 815 Terminal Avenue, where builders buy.
Good morning, Jim Hart here. I have the honor today to represent Jack Webster, who has been off this week and who will be back on Monday. Our topic today is high tech. Think of it this way. About 10,000 people in British Columbia work in high technology. About 21 times that many don't work at all. Why is this? Tom Siddon, who is the Federal Minister of State for Science and Technology, is with us. He's been down to California and signing an agreement in an hour to try and get us some high tech, and we'll find out some more about that. Where are we now? One of the things that high technology is perhaps most obvious for is what you see on television screens. We'll look today with Mark Schneider at the latest in computer graphics.
The stick figures are crude animations, similar in many respects to the earliest of black and white photographs of a century ago. But these ice skaters represent a quantum leap in computer modeling of the human form. A Simon Fraser University project that is creating a new frontier, new opportunities for business.
One other little high-tech trick, how a small firm from Sydney, British Columbia, made some steel spiders for Hollywood. The firm that made them is Robotic Systems International, and we tried to borrow one, but the film company took them all to Hollywood. As well today, Gordon Gibson. Here's a man who has been around the Liberal Party for a while, who's in Edmonton of all places, but he's also helps to be in charge of Discovery Parks. We'll find out from him where high tech is. I want to find out how a suit was made. Trust me on this one. Keith McPherson, the BC Innovation Office. This is an organization that, if you think you have an idea for high technology that could work, Keith will tell you where to go, I think. True, Keith? And Bill Chester, who is president of an organization called the Electronic Manufacturers Association, with over 100 member firms, all of them in high technology in some form or another. We'll take a break and we'll be back with Mr. Siddon on high technology. Tom Siddon, the science minister, why did you say we're not charging toward high tech like we should be? That we're planting too many trees and too few circuit chips? You did say that.
I didn't say that in so many words, Jim. But what I said was, while we must continue to realize what an important industry the forest industry is to British Columbia and all of Canada, that as we move into the next century, people aren't just going to be working in the forest or the mills cutting down trees and making paper or wood chips. While we don't want to destroy that important legacy, we have to find ways to use the new technologies to extract more value from our timber, from our minerals, from our grains and agricultural products. That's what's happening outside Canada's borders around the world, that the new marvels of biotechnology and electronics or microelectronics, computers, are opening up a whole new vista of opportunities for creative people.
And we're not.
We are. We've been making progress. I mean, the headline rather distorts the situation here in British Columbia because we have a number of exciting new ventures underway. As you said in your introductory comment, that amounts to some 10,000 jobs in a province where we have over 200,000 unemployed. Our challenge is to cultivate here in British Columbia and on the West Coast particularly a climate such as the one in California, where a lot of creative-minded people can get together, brainstorm, take the advantages of the newest ideas flowing out of our universities and putting them to work for British Columbia.
We don't have that climate now?
Not to the degree we need.
Why not?
Why not? Because governments have not provided the right kind of incentives, and that doesn't mean cash, but it means that we have to make it easier to patent an idea. We have to create an environment in which teams of creative people can be brought together to turn an idea into a product.
Okay, what kind of an environment is that?
What we call an incubation setting. And Discovery Park here in British Columbia and the Innovation Center at Discovery Park is an example of that type of incubation setting. We have to do it over and over and over again if we intend to build an industry and infect thousands of people with the opportunities that technology provides.
Could you elaborate on incubation
setting? What do we do with a premature child? In a hospital, we put them in an incubator. We provide oxygen, we provide food and sustenance until they're old enough to stand on their own two feet or to be taken home by their parents. And then as they grow, we teach them and bring them to a point of maturity.
High technologists are adults.
We take, well, they may be adults, but ideas are not. An idea is developed toward maturity in the form of a product which has some value in the marketplace. What we have to take is a person with an idea and put them together with a person with capital to finance the development of that idea, someone who understands a business plan, and someone who knows something about markets and trade. And if we bring those four qualities together...
Why can't this naturally happen?
Because in Canadian society we've developed stereotypes. You're either a commerceman, or you're a logger, or you're a truck driver, but we don't, or a banker. We don't have an environment which draws people together in small teams.
We're fighting our national inferiority complex again,
aren't
we?
It's what it is, but it's been easy in a country where we could live on the strength of our natural resources and have for most of this century. The greatest portion of our income is derived from production and export of our resources. And now the world is changing, and we've got to adapt to that change.
Who are the good guys and who are the bad guys in fostering high technology in Canada, in North America? Who's doing the job as a governing body and who ain't?
Well, I don't think any of our governments have been addressing this problem as directly as we ought. There has tended to be a feeling that, well, if we had increased tax credits, if we somehow forced firms owned by foreigners to do more research in Canada by legislation, if we just kept cranking out more bright people from our universities, that all of these problems would be solved. The problem that is number one for Canada is that we have not started with the marketplace. We have to have more people who have an instinct for trade and selling products that we can develop from our natural resources. You have to have the demand before you provide the supply.
Yes, yes.
And we've had far too much emphasis on sophisticated science.
The Americans are good
and not
at that,
enough on the application of science to do useful things.
How do these guys in Singapore and Hong Kong and all of these faraway places know what the heck the market is here so well?
Well, because they use the modern electronic technologies and some old-fashioned methods as well to get out around the world and to find out what the rest of the world is doing. And that is one of our main deficiencies. We have developed in Canada a fantastic space-oriented communication system. Satellites, earth-receiving stations, microwave systems. We don't use those to advantage.
So you're telling me now that not only must we turn out college graduates, not only must we... provide tax incentives and throw money at high tech, but we also got to take the various potential participants, lead them into a room together, and hold their hand till they
get them talking together.
Make corporate love.
Well, you've got to start with a demand for a product, and a scientist does not have a very high appreciation of what the realities of the marketplace are. People who will buy something look for quality at reasonable price that works and does something that they have not been previously able to do. And 95% of those type of end products are imported from outside Canada. 95% of the new technologies are developed outside Canada. If we don't bring ideas from around the world into Canada and then bring these teams of people together in what we call an incubation setting and throw a little money at the front end to help them reach a point of maturity where they can stand on their own two feet, then we're not going to create new industries for Canada. And the point I often make is that for every one of these new start ventures that we can help to bring to a point of maturity, we have the potential beginnings of a new large industry for Canada. Every time government turns their back on creative people working in that type of a team effort, we destroy the opportunity to build a new industry and deploy hundreds or thousands of people.
Have we been turning our back?
I think we have. Yeah.
What did you find in California? You were there last week?
Great, exciting environment, but one that's overbuilt.
Is the government holding everybody's hand there?
They don't have to, because they've developed a natural, I'll use a sophisticated word, synergism. They're all interrelating with one another. Now, the scientific and technical and financial communities are all helping one another to put these teams and these new ventures together. But the problem with the San Francisco area, particularly the Bay Area, is it's reached a point of saturation. And many of these companies now, particularly in the microelectronics area, are looking for a new environment with clean air and clean water and good institutions and creative-minded people in order to bring some of their newest ventures and relocate outside of the San Francisco area. And we'd like
to
capture...
It's right here, folks.
We'd like to capture some of that. Well, I think it is. The west coast of British Columbia
What's
the
obstacle?
Next most attractive place in Canada. Well, there are very few obstacles right now.
What's this deal you're going to sign
except for an access of to adequate investment capital.
What's this deal you're signing with McGeer in, what, an hour?
Shortly later this morning, we should be signing what's called a Memorandum of Understanding. The federal government is engaged in signing such agreements and sub-agreements which involve cost-sharing of programs in all provinces. This Memorandum of Understanding will set out a framework for cooperation between the federal and the provincial government in the use of technology to British Columbia's advantage.
Is this anything more than polite motherhood?
No. I mean, yes, excuse me.
I like the first answer
it's
better.
It's the beginnings of something more, but in a sense, it's motherhood. So in that sense, the answer is no, because we're entering into a protocol, but we're establishing a joint management committee to identify priorities for cooperation in programs that both governments would fund. And that comes later
Agreement. Who's giving who the dollars?
In this case, we will be cost-sharing in all programs that flow from this initiative, 50-50.
Phone Mr. Siddon if you have a question about high tech. The numbers will, I don't know them. They'll appear on the screen. We'll be back in 2 minutes with your calls to Tom Siddon. Phone's in a minute, but let me ask you about the Senate. Are you really going to wipe it out?
No, no one said we're going to wipe it out, but we better modernize it so that they can't obstruct Parliament the way they have been the last 3 weeks.
What do you do to modernize it?
I guess we limit the time that they can delay legislation. I don't know exactly what is coming forward next week, but it's my understanding that Mr. Justice will be
Forgive me,
to
but it would seem to me to be an
initiatives.
Awful waste of the effort to go through a whole constitutional amendment just to limit the time they can debate something.
Well,
be going to do something more.
You know, Jim, I'm not at liberty to comment in detail on what's coming forward. First of all, because I haven't seen it, and secondly, because if Cabinet were discussing it, I wouldn't be telling you about it anyway at this point.
Sure.
So perhaps in a few weeks' time, it'll become evident exactly how we.
What happened? What brought this on? What did they do? Was it being so far away? We've missed.
We inherited a massive federal deficit, $180 billion. The interest costs against that alone are $20 billion, $25 billion in the coming year, and we got to borrow money to pay the interest. I mean, it's ridiculous, but that's what our predecessors left us with. So when Senate obstructs the necessary borrowing authority for weeks and weeks and weeks, which costs us additional money because we've still got to carry our debt and somehow obtain short-term financing at a higher rate of interest, it's irresponsible. It's irresponsible for Senate, knowing that we have no alternative. There's no other way to pay our bills than to borrow money.
Is there any question but that you
or
will...
Or to shut down more programs of government.
Is there any question but that you will reform the Senate? It would seem that you've got enough legislatures on side to get approval for any amendment you want.
Well, I'm not the Prime Minister, and Cabinet will discuss that very question next week.
Is this something that's going to happen soon?
Well, how can I say? How can I say in what degree or how rapidly? Because Cabinet has not sat for a couple of weeks, and when we do...
I guess when you say...
something
I know,
before,
Cabinet ministers have certain confidences,
well,
but
yeah.
I guess I, as a citizen, am concerned that we're going to go through another awful constitutional debate.
No. We're not going to allow a preoccupation with this problem to detract from the number one problem facing Canadians today, and that is to get more people working and to deal with economic issues.
Okay.
That has to be a priority.
Telephones. Here we go. Let me try this. Hello?
Yes.
Go ahead to Mr. Siddon.
Yes, I am.
Hello?
Hello, Mr. Siddon.
Yes, ma'am.
Is there any possibility
that the federal government could have funds towards a polytechnical college comparable to the Ryerson Technical College. At the present, BCIT students and Kwantlen Technology students have nowhere to go once they finish their 2 years. They must go to Ontario, and I believe they're now starting to limit spaces. I feel this is very important for our young people.
Well, ma'am, I was privileged to be at BCIT last Friday morning, where we opened the New Technologies Building, which contains some of the most marvelous equipment and facilities for training our young people in the areas of what's called CAD-CAM and robotics, microelectronics. We're moving toward the kind of program you envisage, but at the present time, students who take those 2 years at BCIT or Kwantlen or the College of New Caledonia can move into an engineering program at UBC or at Simon Fraser and at the University of Victoria. So we have a number of new resources, educational resources, and the challenge is to integrate them to deliver most efficiently the necessary training and education to support this growth of technology that is going to be inevitable.
Aren't we losing jobs at BCIT? How do you feel about this? Isn't BCIT...
How do you mean losing jobs?
Aren't there 150 faculty and other staff who won't be there
next
year?
Well, all I know is that in the new technology areas, the programs are oversubscribed. There are long waiting lists to get into these programs. And if there's measures of restraint being introduced in other areas, in other parts of their curriculum, well, that's a matter for the Board of Governors of BCIT to negotiate with the provincial government.
Seems odd that at the primary training ground for technical staff, when there's such a demand, they'd cut the faculty.
Well, I don't know what the cuts are in what areas. You should ask the Provincial Minister of Advanced Education that question.
Go ahead to Mr. Siddon.
Yes, Mr. Siddon.
Yes, sir.
When are you people in Ottawa going to designate that the funds that are issued to education in B.C. go to education and not into Expo?
Well, that's a good question you ask, sir, and there's a series of discussions underway at present, which will take, I presume, a few months' time between the federal and ministers, the federal minister responsible for advanced education, the Honorable Walter McLean, and provincial ministers of education.
The whole
and
problem here, as
you think
Jim
we
Hart
should,
mentioned to you.
Sir, do you think we should come down with a heavy fist and impose upon the provinces, or should we...
As the funds are for education, then they should be going to education, right?
Well, as a new government, we will hope to persuade the provinces to make an adequate commitment to the needs of our educational institutions, but we will attempt to do it by consultation and a positive, constructive approach rather than by attacking the provincial governments.
Go ahead to Mr. Siddon.
Yes, I'd like to ask him to comment on the fact that in Southern California, where they have this very good electronics industry, there's also a lot more government support of the universities, especially up here, in regards to cutbacks.
There you go.
Well, I'm not sure that's the case, sir. I, many years ago, decided to stay in Canada and to pursue my advanced education in Canadian universities because I couldn't afford to go to Southern California. The reality is that the most advanced universities, such as Stanford and Berkeley and Caltech, charge very high entry fees because they're privately funded universities. As well, private corporations endow those universities in major ways, which is something we're attempting to achieve in Canada, too.
Go ahead to Mr. Siddon.
Good morning.
Yes, sir.
Good morning. As all I keep hearing about high-tech this and high-tech this and Silicon Valley and all these jobs are going to be created, it's a fact that most of the jobs in Silicon Valley are very low-paying and very menial work, and you expect me as a taxpayer to support companies who want to go high tech. Tell me, why should I do so? There's no doubt that high tech is going to come, and it's going. But why, as a government, you keep saying high tech is the answer? It's not the answer.
Well, sir, I agree with you. High tech is not the answer. We're not going to replace the 212,000 people that are unemployed in BC industry by putting them all into laboratories in white coats playing with gadgets. But what high-tech offers for the economy of Canada, and this province particularly, is to strengthen our primary industries, to restore their international competitiveness, and to find ways to extract more value from our resources. For example, instead of exporting mere 2x4s by the carload, we export products that are produced from cellulose fiber, such as complete modularized housing units, furniture, a whole host of derivative products, chemical products extracted from wood. So the potential is not in building a lot of chip factories here in Canada. But taking these marvels of microelectronics and biotechnology, robots and automation, and finding ways to do things more effectively, thus creating more employment in total and more satisfying things to do, and better paying jobs, I might add, sir, for all British Columbians.
The man seems to make a point, though. Why not spend, if you're going to spend a bunch of effort and time, why not spend it developing jobs that are at least interesting and rewarding rather than the low-paying assembly line type work of...
Oh, but Jim, I think the gentleman in that respect was incorrect. I visited Southern California this week, and the people I met are scientists, technologists, innovators, entrepreneurs, who are doing very satisfying work and receiving very satisfying compensation.
It's not
the menial
cheap.
Work is yeah. done offshore, where they can get the work done most cheaply. But the intellectual work, which is what pays dividends,
is
what we can cultivate here in British Columbia to a higher degree than
we You mean
we
could have a plethora of rewarding, high-paying work and
Look,
let somebody
Jim,
else
we
do
have
the
gym? In Canada, some of the most outstanding educational facilities in the world, right here in British Columbia. We send all our graduates into law and in commerce and various other types of disciplines, education, but we don't bring enough of them up with an inclination toward technology and the potential that it offers for satisfying and rewarding careers. And that's something that is going to require a shift in priority, but only if we produce the demand for those skills when students graduate from high school, from university, from graduate school. And in that way, we will be altering the priorities to more closely conform to those of the countries that are our major industrial competitors, where they're producing many more engineers and scientists and technologists, and a lot less accountants and commerce grads and that sort of thing. If we're going to find a way to create the new industry, which will employ the thousands of unemployed British Columbians,
yes,
we have to find the kind of leadership, the teams, the idea people, the small businesses that we can nurture and help to grow, and that will involve changing the focus to this type of science and technology oriented discipline. And it will be very rewarding, I believe, for our young people coming out of our universities today. They want this kind of creative thing to do, but they don't quite know how they can take advantage of it.
Are we capable of doing that?
I don't think we should look to governments to solve all these problems. We have to. There's an entrepreneurial instinct in British Columbia, an orientation to risk-taking among the investment community, for
yes.
example. And all of that money has been going into junior mining stocks and various types of blue-chip investments and real estate. And while it's good to invest in real estate, those who've lived through British Columbia through the past 5 years have seen how difficult a situation they can find themselves in if they put too much of their risk capital into real estate. And then the bottom drops out of the market. We have to encourage an investment instinct in the areas of the new technologies and the application of those technologies to our industries. That will build new industrial capacity. Then people will have meaningful things to do when they go to work in the day, and they'll have a paycheck with which to buy a new home.
Sounds great to me. Thanks, Mr. Siddon.
It'll take a while, but we're working at it.
Gordon Gibson on Discovery Parks and other things when we come back.
Thanks, Jim.
I think we better get the suit out of the way, Gordon. How was your suit made?
My suit was cut with a laser.
How did this happen?
And it fits very well.
Cut with, rather than scissors, rather than a standard cutting machine that you'd find in a textile factory?
That's right. There are many, many parts in a standard suit when you think of all the little pieces that have to fit together, the lining and so on. This particular suit was cut in a Cleveland factory owned by Richmond Brothers, which is a subsidiary of F.W. Woolworth, with whom we have a joint venture to cut trim parts for the automobile industry. And they have for some time been using laser cutters to cut the material, about 2% of the suits in the U.S.
And it doesn't look like a high-tech suit either. Discovery Parks, you're on the board of what, the Discovery Foundation?
Right. Jim,
what are you doing?
You started the show saying I'm in charge of Discovery Foundation. I'm not. Jerry Hobbs is the chairman and Charlie Kingston's the CEO, but I'm on the board and I'm representing them
today.
But
you're the nice guy who's here.
What we do is, in the technology world, we provide advice, we provide space, we provide some money, and we bird dog opportunities.
Are you the incubators of whom the minister was speaking?
We are one of the major incubators, probably the major incubator in British Columbia. We have in our first so-called multi-tenant facility, I'll just tell you some of the groups that are there. An environment monitoring group, optical tape recorder, high-density disk drives, monitoring systems, bubble memory, advanced security systems, mobile data, bio-leaching process, and on and on. These are the kind of small startup firms that have a need not just for space, but to be with others of the same kind, to share experiences.
Let's just take a hypothetical. I've been in the paging business with some of the paging firms in town, and I think there's a need for a new kind of pager that will both beep, throb against my side in places where I don't want to hear a beep, and speak to me when I want to switch on outside after I've left when the throb. So I've got a multi-page pager. I've got a little bit of money and a little bit of knowledge of high tech. What will Discovery Parks do for me?
Okay, you've got a good idea. So probably, first of all, you want some advice as to how to put a business together.
Yes.
And you want to know who can tell you how to draw a business plan, where you can go for various financial sources, how you can protect your idea against competition. One of the first stops should be our innovation office, and Keith McPherson from that office is going to be on the program later. Now, a little bit later, you might need some space. And you might want to be in a climate where other people facing the same problems are. There's an old saw in the venture capital industry that 75% of companies fail.
Yes.
That doesn't have to be the case. We're finding that 75% can succeed if the business side of things is right, because usually the technological or the idea side's right. So if you're in there with other people facing the same problems, we found that a very useful experience. The next thing you may need as you go along, your business is growing. You're not at the stage yet where you have to go a fairly large private placement or the public market, but you need more money. You might then make an application to our Discovery Enterprise Fund, and you go through a peer review process, through an industry review committee, probably the electronics committee in this case, and you'd meet with them, and people who knew quite a lot about the business would say, well, what about this and what about that, Mr. Hart, and so on and so on. And then they would make a recommendation to the board, and you'd get a bit of money or not. Not a lot of money. We make loans of up to $500,000, but most of them aren't that large. We can go higher than that, but we have to have cabinet approval, and we haven't done that yet.
But I can remember McGeer when he announced these Discovery Parks years ago, and I thought, wow. But now there's only a couple of them. They get less money now than they were getting a while ago. Have they failed, or have they not quite succeeded?
No, I think it's not right that they get less money now. For example, the first year of the Discovery Enterprise Program, which are these loans I speak of, and we also take a piece of the company, incidentally, because we want to build a fund that, with successful companies, can help fund other companies down the line. Our first year, we were able to place about $2 million. This year, by March 31st, we will have about $4.5 million placed, all very usefully and carefully, I hope, because it's strictly a private sector operation. We're administering public money for a public purpose, but it's done by private sector individuals.
Have you really been steaming along as well as you'd hoped? Haven't you been a little slow getting off the ground?
No, I don't think so. We have been careful in getting off the ground, because the easiest thing in the world to do is spend public money. And if you spend it foolishly to begin with, you're not going to be entrusted with more of it.
Are you making money or losing it?
It's too early to tell. Most of the ventures that we have invested in so far are coming along well.
You're still a fan. You're not going to quit the board in disgust.
Not at all. I think it's a very useful purpose. We are, as I say, we're not a mega buck outfit. We're a catalyst, but there's a place for a catalyst here. As far as we can see, we're levering dollars 5-1, 10-1, and that needs doing.
Tell me about General Systems Research and how come it's funded by the Vancouver Stock Exchange, yet headquartered in god-awful Edmonton.
Well, it's in Edmonton for a reason which explains why you have to make a long-term investment in technology. 20 years or so ago, the federal government decided that there should be two centers of laser excellence in Canada, as far as they were concerned. So
maybe, can I just interrupt to point out that this is your firm, the firm that made the lasers that cut your suit?
That's right, and copped automobile parts and so on. they made that decision 20 years ago, and therefore, today, when the time comes to commercialize the power of the laser and start making money out of it, the scientists who know how to do this happen to be in Edmonton. 5 years from now, the scientists who know how to do something else will be in Vancouver because of investments that are being made today in Vancouver.
Is the investment climate, the laser expertise in Edmonton aside, is the climate for high technology here fair, good, adequate, or poor?
I would say it's pretty good. Some people in British Columbia kind of have an inferiority complex. You know, how can we possibly do it here in BC? There's the Silicon Valley down there and so on. But I made a list of some of the reasons people are coming here. And they're coming here from the Silicon Valley now, incidentally. And
they
we,
are?
We can see that in our project. They can get a better bang for their buck in R&D here, both because of the value of the Canadian dollar and because of the scientific research tax credits, this federal government program, which allows them, in essence, to double their money. That's very, very important. We are close to Silicon Valley, but not so close that other companies can come along and steal their people, which happens. There's about a 40% per year turnover down there, and
yes.
People would like to avoid that. We have, and this is terribly important, and sometimes Canadians don't appreciate it enough, we have a medical and an educational climate which people value very, very highly. It's a good place to live from that point of view. We have a nice climate, so we're getting... We're getting the kind of technology jobs here. I agree with one of the callers earlier on. We're not getting a lot of low-paying technology jobs, and that's not going to be BC's future. But we're getting high-paying technology jobs.
When are we going to get to the point where high-tech really counts? If there's 20 times as many people out of work as working in high-tech.
Let me give you an example. We are partial funders of a project which is working to improve the economics of harvesting timber in this province. As you know, there's a lot of wood that's left out in the forest because it's too small or gets broken in the process or whatever. We see a machine, a series of machines that could reduce fiber costs in British Columbia dramatically. If that's the case, that protects a lot of jobs because our competitive position in the forest industry, particularly the pulp side, as you know, is very tough right now.
Gordon, I thank you for being with us.
I thank you for having me.
We'll be back with Mark Schneider's marvelous mystery tour of the world of computer graphics.
It's hard to believe, but making pretty pictures on computers has become a billion-dollar industry in North America. And people in British Columbia are desperately trying to break into that industry as well, some with more success than others. It starts at its most simple level in people's homes using sophisticated home computers like the Macintosh. Show me what you do.
Well, for instance, I've got some photographs here or some digital images of Vancouver that I'm using for a expo data disk that I'm producing.
And now, what do we see here? Oh, that looks like the Vancouver skyline.
That's right. I'll scroll it up a little bit, and you can see the
I see a little hand here that you sort of push it
that's
up.
That's right, yeah.
Well, the dome there's the dome. What do you know? How are you doing business-wise?
Well, it's been a little bit slow so far, but I find people are just starting to realize the potential of computer graphics over conventional art. I've worked as a conventional artist for many years.
And you're looking for business.
That's right.
We're going to show you some other examples of people who are working and making pretty pictures with computers, some who have been very successful so far, and some who are still on the brink of success. Vertigo Productions has already broken through the success barrier. It's almost impossible to turn on the TV without seeing some of their work. This Vancouver company is now ready to break through the next barrier, the future generation of computer graphics.
In the past 3 years, we've made lots of pretty pictures for our clients. They've been world-class productions, and we've been very satisfied with them, as have our clients. However, our clients are telling us that they really want to do it themselves, and looking at the marketplace, we've decided that there are lots and lots of large production houses that do want to do this. So we've decided to build a better mousetrap for use by the user rather than ourselves.
And that's your better mousetrap there that we see?
This is a first run of a small part of that better mousetrap. The computer graphics animation system that we're aiming at with our R&D program will be much easier to use than current systems. It'll be less expensive than the current process. It'll perform a lot faster and produce much higher quality results as well. We feel that this will be very attractive to the entertainment industry, the industrial education industry, probably even medical, and other examples such as simulation.
Tell me, are you actively seeking out new investment money?
We continually seek out investment money. It's part of our ongoing plan to bring in more and more individual Canadians on a private basis, those who believe in the product, those who believe in Canadian industry, and those that can see a good investment when they see one.
And what are you, obviously you're having some success in getting investment capital.
Very much. We're quite comfortable.
The stick figures are crude animations, similar in many respects to the earliest of black and white photographs of a century ago. But these ice skaters represent a quantum leap in computer modeling of the human form, a Simon Fraser University project that is creating a new frontier, new opportunities for business.
Everyone has seen, I guarantee, is the TV station logos. Many, many TV station logos are now generated with computer animation. You see the wonderful letters of the TV station rolling through space. And frankly, for us in computer graphics, we've seen about enough of those, and one more we'll probably throw up. But we look for more complex animation. In advertisements, they're always looking for new. Also, motion pictures. There's a motion picture that was released last summer, The Last Starfighter. That's 25 minutes of very high-quality computer animation.
And do they start basically with simple figures like this and the ideas to make them more elaborate?
They certainly do, usually much simpler than this. These are some of the most complex figures around that anyone is doing.
In North America, these right here?
Yes, these right here.
Tell me, Gary, what do you have to know about anatomy and human motion to get the computer to do that?
Well, a fair bit if you want to do a really good job. What you don't necessarily need to know is anything about computers, and that's the important feature of this. We do have people who are anatomists, dancers, figure skaters coming in and being able to specify their movement. This particular sequence you saw on the screen of two figures skating together and the man picks the woman up was done by a skater, not a computer scientist. She came in here and was able to enter the data, no problem at all. She spent about a couple of hours learning how to do it, and that was it.
Do you think your work here is going to have any commercial value?
We in the university can do some parts of this work. People in industry have to do the other parts. We try out new ideas. Having got them to a certain point, we have to transfer them to industry.
Softech is one small business trying to do its part. With the assistance of the BC Innovation Office, they're creating graphics for small computers to help engineers design buildings. Their pictures are strictly utilitarian, like this one, which shows a three-story building collapsing under wind and weight.
What makes our tool interesting is it's fun to use. It's interesting to the engineer to use. It's fun. It makes his work enjoyable. What really important is we have the graphics, and that shows the engineer what the building is doing. It for the first time, the engineer can get a graphic representation of how the building's actually performing and get a really feeling for what that building's doing.
How good is your program?
Well, it's very good. It's
very good.
It's the best.
Well, that's a little bit stronger.
It's the best in North America, beyond a doubt.
Are you sure about that?
Absolutely. We track all of our competitors. We have a listing of all of our competitors in the files right there. There's only about 15 to 20 very serious competitors in this business, and they're all offering something that's pretty bland, that's been around for a long time. We've taken a very refreshingly different approach with our product. We offer colors, for example, that other people just don't.
Well, let me stop you there. I don't mean to be too sarcastic, but if you're so smart, how come you ain't rich? I mean, three partners, small office, Vancouver, why aren't you known worldwide? What's the problem?
Well, at this point in time, we're just getting into the final phase of our marketing effort. We've got our focus, we've identified what our product is, what it's gonna look like.
You could be selling millions of dollars, right?
We definitely could be selling millions of dollars.
But
at this stage in time, we're short on marketing. We need capital for doing intensive marketing.
You gotta find people to invest.
We're looking for people to invest in our company.
And why haven't you found them so far?
Well, there's a very strong reluctance on the part of investors to invest in software industry. The most common...
You're not building hardware, you're not building things, right?
We're building software, and investors always say software is intangible. They really don't understand it. They can't touch it, feel it, smell it, etc.
But it makes pretty pictures.
It makes pretty pictures, and the other thing that investors tend to overlook when they say software is intangible, it's a multi-billion dollar a year industry.
And you want a piece of that, and you need people to believe in your product.
We have clients who believe in our product. We need an investor or a group of investors that believe in our product.
The future of computer graphics is changing so fast that today's technology is almost obsolete by tomorrow. Take this computer room at Simon Fraser University. 2 years ago, it represented the leading edge of computer technology. Today, you can buy a lot more for a lot less. And if BC wants to keep in touch with those changes, it's got to be prepared, not only with more imagination and more innovation, but most important of all, with investment.
Let's speak about investment and innovation with a man who represents the established firms in the industry and another man who deals with firms or people who want to get into firms in high tech, right after this break. How does high tech get started? How does a firm come about in British Columbia in the high technology field? Keith McPherson's with the Discovery Foundation's what, Innovation Office?
Yeah, BC Innovation Office.
And Bill Chester, you have over 100, 120, is it? Member firms in the Electrical Manufacturers?
The Electronic Manufacturers Association of BC.
Are they all doers of high tech or some in the business of distributing it?
There are some distributors, some consultants, but the majority of them are manufacturing products and selling products from BC here, ranging from the large companies like Microtel and McDonald Detweiler and Associates, who are probably some of the best known, to small outfits like Modern Electronics, for example, a two-man outfit making home protection devices for the domestic market.
These are actually guys putting circuit chips together that can be sold for people's homes?
Yes, yes.
What does Microtel do?
Well, Microtel, of course, are the telephone people. The old name was Lenkard Electric, who made
something to do with the phone. They make phones.
They make the transmission equipment for telephone systems and all the switch gear and many large type of assembly.
McDonald Detweiler, are they the outfit that makes the computer screens for cars?
No, that's another one, which is actually an offshoot from McDonald Detweiler. McDonald Detweiler are probably the leaders in space imaging and satellite imaging from on ground stations for producing photographs, high definition photographs from satellite information.
Space imaging. What does that truly mean?
What it means is taking pictures. As we traditionally know, photographs, mm-hmm. and splitting them up into little pieces so that their elements can be enhanced individually and then put back together. They can't really be called photographs, but you produce a much better image from
the same
the
kind
original.
Of technology that gives us the daily weather satellite photos on the news.
Precisely.
Oh, isn't that interesting? Okay. How do I get started? What will you do for me?
Well, the first thing that one has to do when you're trying to get a business started, as I'm sure Bill will tell you, is that one has to get a team of people together.
Mm-hmm. Do you need a better idea? Is there a problem with better ideas?
No, there's no problem with better ideas in British Columbia. Our basic problem here at the moment is good teams of innovators and innovative entrepreneurs in the province. And what the BC Innovation Office does, what we do, is to help those entrepreneurs to develop business plans and package them, and hopefully to sell those to the investment community.
What is a business plan?
Business plan is basically a statement of the objectives of the company. What does the company want to do? How do they see the opportunity that they see in front of them? And how do they intend to exploit that opportunity?
So in the case of Modern Electronics making, two-man firm making security systems.
Yes.
You would say, okay, you want to make these security systems, then what do you do? They come to you, and what happens?
Well, normally what we do is we take them through a step-by-step process of assisting them to develop their business ideas and their business plans.
What are some of the steps?
The first step is basically to build a case for the commercialization of the idea. Now, commercialization is a long word. It means bringing ideas to the marketplace.
Is that anything like will it sell?
Will it sell? Does it work? Does the idea belong to them? And is there a good business opportunity here? Can they make it for a price which will sell and make a profit?
Does the idea belong to them? Is this a big deal?
Yes, it is, because if the idea may not belong to them, supposing someone else had had the idea and patented it, supposing they started manufacturing it, well, then a company that that said, well, we own that idea, they may come along and say, well, no, you can't make it.
Is it a patent search that establishes whose idea it is?
A patent search will establish whether or not the idea has been patented already by someone else, whether someone else has already claimed the idea.
Is a patent search a routine matter like the title search of a house you want to buy?
Yes, it's a routine matter. There are a number of excellent patent agents in Vancouver who do this work on a routine basis. In fact, there are computers now that do patent searches for us.
If I came to you and said I had $100,000 to invest, could you point me at something that would be a good investment?
That isn't our first job, but yes, we could point you at some of the innovative teams that have come to us that have got to the business planning stage. But that's not our first concern. Our first concern is to help these people get their businesses together.
Get their businesses together.
Yes. But as I said to you, to start with, is building that case.
Money was getting a business together.
That's true, but first you have to build a case which will attract that money. Secondly, you need a team of people, as Mr. Siddon said earlier. Thirdly, you need to decide how you're going to make money at it. Are you going to, say, for example, license or sell the idea to an existing company, or would you start your own business? Perhaps you'd want to start your business in your basement. So those kinds of options have to be discussed thoroughly and looked at very carefully before the next stage, where we saw Softech was working in, is basically the trial market and development stage. They have developed the prototypes, they have a product, and now they're testing the market. And at the moment, they're developing a business plan.
What is it you still want? What's the number one gap to be filled?
The number one gap to be filled, as Mr. Siddon said, is basically in seed capital investment. But number two, and as important, is to improve the level of entrepreneurship in BC, to improve the climate for entrepreneurs in our province.
True. Would you have more members if the climate were better?
The climate can always improve for any business. I would modify Keith's description and say that essentially in the industry and our members, we feel that probably the biggest lack is experienced or seasoned management. And that is one of the
seasoned
reasons.
Seasoned management, not seasoned technologists.
We have a surfeit of schools that produce good technical people. We have as many technical people, I believe, as we can absorb here right now. It's managing those resources, both the human resources and the available fiscal resources that are in the area to advantage, that is the number one problem.
Do we have to raid Silicon Valley to get these guys?
That is one way. I suspect, many of us feel, that we probably have to go and raid somewhere in order to get the process started.
You're going to say something?
Yes, I was going to say something. I totally agree with what Bill was saying here. When I was saying improve the climate for entrepreneurship here and raising the level of management capability means improving our entrepreneurs themselves through a process of self-help. That's basically where we're coming to.
Let's take a break. Open the phone lines. I still haven't memorized the numbers. They'll appear on the screen. We'll be back with Keith and Bill and Gordon and your calls in a couple of minutes. Gordon Gibson from the Discovery Foundation has rejoined us. Let's go to a telephone call. Go ahead to our panel.
Yeah, I'd like to first make a comment, if I could, on what the science minister mentioned, how they're coming up here for clean air and clean water. And I'd like to take that aspect and ask the gentleman here what he thinks is going to happen in the next 15 to 25 years, because the electronic industry has one of the highest, products of pollution and toxic waste from processing printed circuit boards and this kind of thing. And it seems that mankind in general, we've got more technology than we know how to deal with. The military steps in when something new comes along and they want to use it to make more warheads or better targeting systems, and then the whole the whole intricacies of high tech get so complicated that a little bug somewhere crashes.
Hang on a second there. You sound positively paranoid, my good man.
Well, pollution is, I think, mankind's biggest problem, and where everybody's bypassing the issue of clean air and clean water and future for our grandchildren and great-grandchildren, et cetera, et cetera.
Stop,
and
everybody's chasing the buck here. Stop or we'll run out of time on the program. What about it, guys? Is high-tech a dirty business?
I think the caller has a valid point. There are cyanide salts involved with various processes. However, as we proceed to even smaller and smaller microcircuits and so on, the amount of chemicals involved are much, much smaller. The toxic wastes that appear in the air are virtually nil. And in fact, it's an improving situation. And as we go on, our own technology and our chemical high-tech people have taught us how to deal with our waste quite effectively.
There, don't you feel better?
I'll even give the caller some good news. We've just developed a new chemical scrubber in our lab in Edmonton.
Okay. Go ahead to our panel.
Is it true that there's no support to manufacture software that's licensed from somewhere else?
Can you say that again another way?
Software, say that's developed in the United States, and you get a license to manufacture it in Canada. Is that true that there's no support to manufacture licensed software in BC?
I'm not quite sure here, you know, what you mean by manufacture licensed software, because it would seem to me that if you're licensing software from the United States, then the software has already been manufactured. I'm a little puzzled about the question.
Let's go to a call here from Castlegar. Hello.
It seems to me that they've gone into this high tech so heavily that they just don't have anything else on their minds, you know. I was down to the innovation office here about 3 weeks ago, and they were absolutely no assistance to me at all. I'm unemployed, but I still have ideas. And it ended up, it cost me, I think, $45 for Barrigar and Oya and a law firm in Vancouver. They were no assistance, and I can get no assistance anywhere. I have real good ideas, and I know that they are marketable.
Recognize the voice, Keith?
No, I don't, but I'm very concerned about the caller's question, and what I would say is, please give us another try.
Can we, maybe we can get this man's number off the air on the long distance call. Let me go to, hello.
Hello.
Go ahead to our panel.
And to Mr. Gibson. Mr. Gibson?
Yes.
My question is, if I have a product that is, I think, which is viable, how do I, or what do I do now in order to get ahead a little bit further once I can get down to the innovations office?
Well, I think, as you say, your first stop is the innovations office if you're right at the beginning stage, if you're in the startup stage, and Keith and his people, it's a small office. I don't want to suggest it's a large office, but they will give you help in, as Keith explained, writing your business plan and various kinds of intellectual property protection, one thing and another. After that stage, really it's up to the entrepreneur to get out and round up some support for the first level to prove to people that there are other people in the private sector who think that there's some value in this. Then at that point, if the idea is proving out, if the research or the development is coming along well, at that point he's probably in the right stage of development to go to third-party financiers, which might include the Discovery Foundation.
Go ahead to our panel.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, I am an electronics technician. I have been trying to get a job in the field for about a year and a half, and I am not getting anywhere. The one gentleman stated that there was enough jobs to go around. More than enough jobs to go around. How would I get into it?
Got any management experience?
No, I haven't.
Is that a problem right there, guys?
Well, what I would say is that I think we in BC at this juncture have to look at entrepreneurship as a way of creating jobs rather than looking to the workplace to find jobs for ourselves. There were some studies done at UBC about a week or so ago that indicate that by this means something like 20 to 40,000 new jobs could be created a year in British Columbia.
So what this man needs is a good idea and take to you.
Yes, or somebody who has a good idea that maybe he could work with. We've done quite a number of things of that nature.
Why don't you start your own business, caller?
Lack of funds to begin with.
You can solve that, can't you, Keith?
I wouldn't say we can solve that. I'd say, well, let's have a look at it. Give us a try.
Go ahead to our panel.
You guys are talking a lot about creating jobs, and so are a lot of other people these days. Could these three gentlemen please address the problem of a market for what is being produced? I'll hang up and listen to your answer.
Okay.
Who wants to go first? Well, I think that the membership of our association, to varying degrees, is well aware that we are operating in a worldwide market for all our products. And our own particular experience is that producing in British Columbia, we've always had to consider export, even if, and I may be using trigger words here, even if it's only to Alberta. We've never had a domestic market for most of our products which was large enough to support the R&D that has gone in. And as far as the electronics sector is concerned, there is a worldwide marketplace. Despite the Japanese and Far Eastern production, there are gaps in production in Europe right now. My own company, in fact, is taking technology from here to fill those gaps. So we have no problem with identifying markets for our products.
Let's pause here, pay some bills. If you want to get involved, don't know who to call. Last opportunity, almost the last, is right when we come back. Call us. Good heavens, I think we've solved it. Just during the last commercial break, if we put together a good business team, we'll have prosperity aplenty. You were saying already that the number one thing is lack of good supervisors, good managers.
I think that's true, Jim, and I don't think there would be too many people who would take issue with the fact that that is probably our number one drawback right now. As we were discussing in the break...
Can't you train them?
You can train them to a certain degree, but it's the old bugaboo that there is no better training ground than the marketplace itself. And that means that we either have to get them from somewhere else, or having given them the basics of management training, send them somewhere else, and then hope to repatriate them to grow later. It's not a short-term
proposition. If he's out there watching now, Keith, and he's got the moxie and the idea and the experience, is he going to get the money?
If he has a business plan together and if he has a business team together. Now, coming back to the idea of can you train entrepreneurs, the answer is you can no more train entrepreneurs in a classroom than you can teach people to dance by giving them a book of dance steps. The thing is that you want to be able to practice it. And
yes.
We at the Innovation Office firmly believe that what you do is to give these people the opportunity to access the skills that they need to build those teams.
Let's go to a telephone call here. Go ahead to our panel.
Hi. Hi, I would like to refer my question to Keith McPherson.
Shoot.
Okay, and by the way, I'd like to disagree with the previous caller. I have phoned Keith McPherson last year on a number of occasions, and I find him to be very informative. My name is Sarah Colleray. I believe Keith may recall the name on a project that we've come up with. The question, but he has been very informative.
Let's have the question, please.
I'm on my edge of my seat here.
The question is it normal procedure to take 6 weeks for a search?
For a patent search?
For a search on a project. And why do we have to go through the United States? What's happening in Canada that we cannot do this ourselves?
Are we talking about patent searches? Ah, okay. The reason that you would do a search of United States patents is because, in general, most Canadian patents are patented in the United States, but the reverse is not true. So if you do a search of American patents, you will find most of the patents that there are, whereas if you do Canadian patents, there's far, far fewer of them, and so you may miss one.
Does it take 6 weeks?
It may take longer than that if you're using a proper search.
Go ahead to our panel. Hello.
I think that we have some very excellent high-tech businesses in British Columbia, but I think it's a shame that some of them are having to set up manufacturing plants outside the country because they're taxed so heavily by both the government that it makes it worthwhile for them to do their manufacturing elsewhere, which cuts down on the number of jobs in British Columbia.
Can can this possibly be true, Bill?
Yes, I'm afraid it is. And without trying to look like a mutual admiration society here, this is, I think, a problem that many governments have. The fact is that with increased technology and increased skills in these technologies, you are going to find a natural migration of manufacturing facilities closer to the marketplace. And what we have to do here is not look at the jobs that are exported, but look at those that we can attract to this part of the world. But this is one of the things that our members have dealt with for some time now, that you must provide the technical support close to your marketplace. And in many cases, this means putting the plant there.
A call again. Go ahead, Castlegar.
Good morning. Yes, I'm phoning in regards to a particular idea I have that has an international market. And it has lots to do with high tech. I'm curious about patents. The patents being, how do I go about doing a search and et cetera? Because I have believed that it could be abused or taken by other people.
That's a normal concern that most inventors would have for their product. What I suggest you do is phone our office and they will send you a little booklet called Patents Non-Disclosure Agreements, and it explains very simply what the steps are in doing this patent search and taking some elementary steps to protect your idea.
Okay, is this an answer that it can apply to anyone with a better idea? Call you?
We would like to think so.
We better get your number, Keith.
688-6755.
In the phone book under?
Discovery Foundation, BC Innovation Office.
In the blue or the white pages?
In the white pages.
Let's take one more phone call here before we have to clear the decks. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yes?
Is the high-tech industry going to be a major employer?
I think unequivocally yes, but the time frame will probably cause some concern both to our own member companies, to the public at large, and I think certainly to our politicians, because it seems to be that the syndrome of putting a man on the moon within 10 years assumes that we can create millions of jobs in 3 or 4, and it just isn't going to happen that quickly.
15 seconds. Go ahead.
Small investment now will yield very large dividends in jobs 5 years, 10 years down the road. It's important to do it.
Robots won't replace us all, though, will they?
Robots will help us all.
Okay. Future generation, wondering what they're learning in schools now, wondering what they're not learning in schools now, how computers will help. Had a chat with a fellow about that, and we'll play the tape when we get back out of here. A computer from your office, a computer for your business, okay, but a computer for your five-year-old? Colin Dawes and Gary Gumley are two former teachers who say maybe your five-year-old should. How come, guys?
Well, as being teachers, we specialize in educational software, and we find that using the computer to work with your children and teaching them letter recognition and word recognition is very helpful in increasing their educational
Sesame
skills.
Sesame Street won't do the full job?
What this can do is motivate the child. It's interactive. You work with the computer, whereas you're not.
Which has been one of the main criticisms of Sesame Street. The kid sits there like a potato for an hour, and it all comes at him, but he doesn't get to do anything back.
That's the greatest advantage of the computer, is the fact that the children get an opportunity to interact with something and get some positive feedback for something that they've done.
Well, let's stop fooling around then and see if we can pass the test here, guys.
Okay.
This is just a standard, an Apple IIc?
This is an Apple IIc, yes. It's probably the computer that has the most educational software available for it at this point in time.
Is this something that I'd buy at home?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so we're into a home computer.
Yes, definitely.
Show us how it works.
What we have here is one example of many, many types of software, Jim, that is available on the market today. This one is called Reader Rabbit by a company called The Learning Company out of California. They've put together a good number of programs that are very good quality educational software programs. This one is designated to a particular age group, the 5 to 7-year-old age group. And as you'll see as we run through this particular part of the program, it's designed to discriminate between different types of letters and the position of letters in three-letter words.
So, let me get this straight. Mm-hmm. The kid is going to look at these words and tell what?
Whether the letter is in the correct position for the word that's coming up on the screen.
Okay, let's do it.
Okay. What we're going to do here is just choose the letter that we want to pick by changing these three pointers here. And in this particular one, we're going to choose the R in the first word.
So we're asking the child to pick out what? All the words that That's begin with R?
That begin
that come
with the letter
the
R. That's correct, yeah.
Okay.
We can also adjust the speed, 1, 2, or 3. It's just an internal timer in the program.
So this is adjusting the speed with which the letters, or the words
the
come
words,
on the screen?
The
or
words
what?
Will appear on the okay. screen. Yeah, that's right. So we'll choose the slowest one because I haven't.
We're
I'm
slow.
Not too good. That's right. Okay, so we just press the space bar to begin, and the letters will appear. In this instance, we push it to the, because it is what we want, we push it to the right, because this one is not what we want, it goes into the garbage, which is most appropriate.
So we're picking out the ones that begin with R and putting them on the stack.
That's correct. This is, as I say, one part of the program that's
into
called
the garbage.
Sorter.
That's interesting.
Yeah. It's good visual reinforcement for the children because they know that this isn't the
one.
Correct word. So now we did a wrong one, an incorrect one there. So we're now finished the five, but we got, as you can see with the green and the red, four
out of five. Gary, not bad.
Well, 80%, you know. So if we wanted to run it again and we get them all correct, I'll just speed it up a little bit so we can go a little bit faster here. The letter is repeated, the first letter is repeated, but they go into the garbage a little bit more quickly this time.
Yep, we're really clipping along now.
When we get them all correct.
The bunny jumps up and down.
Which, as you were saying about Sesame Street, is the same type of thing we were talking about earlier.
Okay, tell me honestly, Colin, did you ever run into any kid with this problem in school?
Yes, I did.
Oh, jeez. I worked
in.
No.
I worked with learning assistance classes, and a lot of children had difficulty recognizing the difference between B's and D's, for example. And this kind of program can help them discriminate more rapidly by practicing that kind of thing.
I guess the concern that I'd have before I'd lay out a bunch of dough for either a computer or these programs is knowing what I want.
That's the most important thing to do. Find out what it is you need.
If the kid can't add, for example, how do I know what it is in the process of addition that he's not doing? Can a teacher identify that?
Oh, absolutely. And as trained people, we feel that we can identify those kinds of things. One of the things that we're doing with our in our location out in Delta is that we are helping parents to identify those kinds of problems. And having the students use the computers at our location to be able to discriminate between those kinds of things.
Well, can I drop my little monster off at your store for a few days and you could analyze them?
What we do is we...
How do you find this out?
What we do is we have the children come into the store once a week.
Yep.
And they use our computers in the back with a fully qualified teacher and the various types of educational software. We must have 1,500 different titles in our store.
At least.
Of educational software, ranging all the way from pre-kindergarten right up to college and university level programs. So there's algebra, there's geometry, there's mathematics at every different kind of level that you can use the computer with. Now, the thing is that the positive feedback that you're getting from the computer is phenomenal. At the end of the day, what we like to see a lot of parents, what we tell a lot of parents is, how many times have you sat at the kitchen table with your child and it's tears time and I'm tired and I don't want to do this anymore, and there's a lot of problems because the parent has expectations of their child can't do it. Computer doesn't care how long the child takes to get a correct answer. As soon as the correct answer comes up, the computer's going to say, hey, way to go. And that is really positive.
So
you're really
buying patience.
You're buying patience.
You could do this with flashcards and a lot of perseverance at home.
Well, mm-hmm. No, I think that the difference is with this is it's like Marshall McLuhan would call it a hot medium. You get immediate feedback from the computer, whether you're right or wrong. And if you're right, you get a positive feedback. You don't have to wait for a delayed reaction. Now, you could do it with your...
Won't we have intellectual burnout with this the same way kids have gotten sick of video games? They're just... The fad's over.
We have found that not to be true. And now, of course, it's a new technology into the schools and into the kind of things that we do with it. And we find that more often we have to tell the children that their hour is up and it's time for them to leave, rather than them saying, gee, I'm tired, I want to go now.
You brought up an interesting point a little while ago, though, about the cost of these vis-a-vis... Is it worth it?
Yes.
I think there's a very valid point to be made about this. They are expensive, there's no doubt about it.
How much is this program?
Well, this particular program, Read a Rabbit, which I've only shown you one part of, is about a $48, $50 program.
But?
The point is that when people choose educational software, they have to look for appropriate things to purchase. And some of the things that we tell people to look for in educational software is the ability to, they first have to have to identify what they want to use the software for. They secondly have to purchase software that can be user authorable. Now, by that I mean, can you put in things into the package that will allow the parents to take, for instance, a spelling list from school and put it into the package and manipulate the package that way. Those kinds of things are well worth it and well worth looking for in a piece of software.
Gentlemen, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
A break, and we'll be back. So, the Discovery Foundation is in the phone book, The White Pages. On Monday, on this program, Marilyn Rossner, a psychic who is also a professor of special education, helps the police, helps disturbed children, and Jack will be back Monday at 9 a.m. precisely. Frankly, I'd like to see Jack Webster right across the network, have his own slot every day. I think that would be great. Doing it from the West Coast.
This has been the Webster Show. I'm Pamela Wallen. I enjoyed my day sitting in here in Jack's chair talking to all of you in beautiful British Columbia. Hope to see you soon.
Are you saying that you think that we should have legalized prostitution in Canada then, sir?
Why not? It's the oldest profession.
Oh, no, it's the second oldest.
Well, what would you call the first oldest?
Selling insurance.
Okay, I'll buy that.
Two things I said I would never do during my career in television. One of them was substitute for Norm Grumman on the weather when he was away or on vacation. And the other was do this particular program, but I'm here this morning for the next 90 minutes. I won't do the weather.